What is next for you? You're not going to ride off into the sunset.
No, I'm not good enough at golf to do that. So I'll be investing. I'll be a senior advisor to the firm. Keep in touch with Bain Capital. My family office is focused on biotechnology, space, and technology. So very busy, and have a couple of sports teams. Atalanta, which just won 8-2 on the most goals ever scored on Sunday night. Got to see him over in Bergamo. So I'll be focused on those activities. And I've just been a wonderful run at Bain Capital, and so fortunate to have been in such a great firm.
And the Celtics, the only team in the NBA with over a 700 winning percentage. You're on a roll, but will the private equity deal market, Stephen, be on a roll this year? Higher rates, still questions about China, questions about Europe's health, where you are with their energy crisis. How will private equity and deal making look the next 12 to 24 months?
Well, I think we're looking at maybe three major themes in the next 5 years. The first one's going to be this decoupling strategically from China. So it's not going to be everything, but it's decoupling essential things like medical supplies and chips. And you see the CHIPS Act. I was with Gina Raimondo last week. They're putting lots of money into making sure we can be self-sufficient for chips and medical equipment. I think the second thing that you're seeing is now pulling back of the money supply, you know, which we now have more normalized interest rates. Brian, you know, most of our lives, interest rates have been 4 to 5%. This has been a very strange period since the crisis where they've been sub 1% on the T-bill. Now they're kind of going back to normal, and I think we're going to see more volatility in that as inflation goes up and down and the Fed plays with those rates. But I don't think we're going to see 1% rates anytime soon, so we got to get used to that interest rate environment. And then finally, the whole energy transition issue is big because that's going to cause inflation. We're going to have to build a second infrastructure for energy. And I think we've underinvested in oil and gas exploration the last 10 years as those companies have been milked because of the current financial situation. So we're going to have to really figure out a plan with the government on how we do achieve carbon neutrality, but do that in a way where people still have heating and we can have the economy function. So those are the issues facing us in the next 5 to 10 years, and that'll impact the next couple years as well.
Stephen, we could do a half an hour interview on just those topics alone. Sadly, we don't have time. We'll talk to Dan Yergin in a few minutes about oil and gas. You bring up an excellent point. I mean, and I don't want to make it political, but the reality is what we hear from the administration, we need more oil. Why aren't they investing more money and producing more oil? But if you look on sort of under the hood of the financial markets, tell our viewers how difficult it is to obtain financing, particularly private financing, for big oil and gas infrastructure projects. I mean, there's so many regulations, and that's not corporate America whining. This is the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency. All these things we don't think about make it a lot more difficult than it should be. Is that a fair statement?
Well, it's been difficult for two reasons. One, financiers lost billions of dollars on the shale boom. Really, not many people made money on that. So that's caused a pullback in terms of lending. And then secondly, we do have to have policies to have a balanced approach, and hopefully there'll be financing available. The general finance markets are tough right now because interest rates are going up, and prices really haven't adjusted down as much as they should. So it's starting to happen. People are going to get used to this new normalized environment. The good news is the banks are very well capitalized. Banks like J.P. Morgan, Bank of America, their balance sheets are very strong, so we're not in that situation. Most of the money that's been lost has been in equity, so that's not going to have a multiplier effect.
Yeah, that's an excellent point, that oil and gas was kind of like the airline sector for a long time. It's where capital went to literally get put into a hole in the ground. You mentioned the the energy transition, Stephen. I was just at an energy conference 2 weeks ago. So much optimism around it from financing perspective, because in part, people viewed it as a couple, 10 or 100 billions of dollars in tax credits and incentives that are sitting around. How profitable is the transition going to be for Wall Street? I got the impression a lot of the oil guys were suddenly becoming solar guys.
Well, I think the country needs to do it, and private enterprise needs to step up, and I think the government's doing the right thing, making us have that transition. This generation, certainly the folks we hire into Bain Capital now, are more concerned about the environment than ever before. So we have to get this done, and it's going to cost money, but it's money we need to spend to save the planet. So I think it'll be a good investment environment. It'll be a little bit inflationary because you're going to have to maintain two structures for quite a period of time. because this is a huge transition. Think about moving from oil and gas to solar and wind. It's gonna take quite a while and big investments and big infrastructure to get power to cars and factories and all the things we need power for.